Good morning. With not a single bill being passed in the last 2 months and the National Assembly's regular session beginning today, will the prolonged deadlock continue? Russian President Vladimir Putin has called for statehood for separatist-held eastern and southern Ukraine. Billions of locusts invaded rural areas in Haenam-gun County, Jeollanam-do Province. The situation is brought under control, but not without damage. And finding out about the coffee culture in Korea. What are some of its characteristics? One man set out to find out on Korea Today, Monday, September 1st, 2014.
From Arirang News, this is Korea Today.
Good morning and welcome to Korea Today on this Monday morning. Hope you had a great weekend. I'm Kim In-jung alongside Kim Yang and Oh Jin-ju. This weekend, everyone seemed to be out and about trying to buy gifts for their friends and family for the Chuseok holidays that's coming up. In about a week.
Right.
That's right.
And this year's Chuseok falls earlier than usual according to the lunar calendar. And this is why prices of fruits is going to shoot up as it's not yet at the peak harvest season. Mm-hmm. So more customers are turning to hongsam or insam or ginseng or red ginseng mm-hmm. for Chuseok gifts this year.
And those are great gifts for your health, parents, families, cousins, you name it. They like it
Even
and they'll enjoy it.
Kids
exactly.
Enjoy
it's
hongsam.
Great for you and it's very healthy at the same time, but wow, you know, there's so many different options out there. It's great to see that ginseng or Korean insam, it's shooting up there, right?
Are you sending me ginseng this time?
Well, you know, I will send you ginseng. I will send ginseng to anyone else, but I will send my mom and dad cash because that's the way they like it.
Yeah.
Right. We're going to go to our top story for this morning. Now, there are pending bills piling up at the National Assembly, and it is set to begin a 100-day regular session today, but the prolonged deadlock between rival parties threatened to affect even the government's 2015 budget proposal. The special law aimed at uncovering the events that led to and followed the sinking of the Sewol-ho ferry has been the subject of the ongoing political wrangling, and with that, lawmakers have not processed a single bill since July, with the main opposition New Politics Alliance for Democracy staging sit-ins and boycotting parliamentary proceedings. The 2015 spending needs the approval from the National Assembly by the end of November, or the government risks starting the year with a provisional budget that only covers the basics and could halt payments to government employees, the elderly, and people in need.
Washington has reaffirmed that its North Korea policy remains unchanged, calling on Pyongyang to not just talk the talk, but walk the walk as well. White House National Security Council spokesman Patrick Vetrell told reporters that genuine and reliable negotiations can take place between the two sides only if North Korea shows that it can denuclearize and stay committed to its pledges. The latest announcement comes amid unconfirmed reports that U.S. officials had flown to Pyongyang for a meeting with their North Korean counterparts last month. The spokesman didn't confirm or deny that the meeting had taken place, but did add that North Korea should contact the U.S. Special Envoy for six-party disarmament talks for any official communication.
Korea ranked 8th in global trade volume during the first half of 2014, one notch higher than last year. According to a report by the Institute for International Trade, Korea's trade volume came to $546 billion from January to June 2014. 71 major countries were included in the evaluation, which showed Korea's exports grew 2.5% on year to $283 billion during the first half, the seventh largest in the world, while imports came in to $263 billion, the ninth largest. China topped the list with its overall trade volume reaching $2.02 trillion, followed by the United States with $1.98 trillion.
Today, we're going to look into an industry that has come into the spotlight along with a rapidly developing domestic economy. Korea's packaging machine industry has become a crucial part in the manufacturing sector, and with these machines now being exported globally, the nation is showing great potential of becoming a major player in this field. To tell us more, we connect live to our Kim Chan-ju. Good morning, Chan-ju.
Good morning, Jinju. I'm at the Agricultural Product Distribution Center, where in this particular section, our automatic packaging for rice takes place. And you can see many bags of rice there, obviously very busy preparing for Chuseok holiday. Now, Korea's automatic packaging machinery industry account for 33 trillion won, or 32 billion U.S. dollars, the double the amount compared to the global market. So with that, let's take a look at the development and the scale of Korea's automatic packaging industry in this next report. This is the construction site for an agricultural product distribution center by the National Agricultural Cooperative Federation, or better known as Nonghyeop, located in Paju, Gyeonggi-do Province. The center will distribute rice and farm products produced in Paju area. Newly installed automatic packaging system is expected to triple productivity instead of relying on manpower.
The automatic packaging system can handle between 600 to 800 bags per hour, compared to the 200 to 300 per hour in the past, so productivity will be improved.
Swift packaging is essential when it comes to delivering products delivered to and from various regions across the country. This is why automatic packaging machines are necessary at agricultural product distribution centers. Here's where you can find the current status of Korea's packaging industry. This particular packaging company has been developing and exporting automatic packaging machines for over 20 years. Up to 90% of Korea's agricultural product distribution centers have installed the system from this company.
Automatic packaging machines can wrap all agricultural products, petrochemical products, and special medicines. Personnel expenses used to be lower in the past, so we didn't use machinery, but now we use robotic automatic packaging machines, which can handle products considered unsanitary and dangerous to people.
Korea's automatic packaging machine system was underdeveloped in the 1970s. But it was during the 1980s that the industry found its basic form. By the 1990s, packaging machines applied a combination of robotic machines along with bio and IT technology, leading Korea to become the exports country it is today. The global automatic packaging machine industry continues with a steady growth of 4.6% annually, while the Korean market increased by 10% last year, marking it as a growing competitor on the global stage. The main importers of Korea's automatic packaging machines include China, Japan, and the US. Lately, developing countries like Indonesia and Vietnam have been mass importing these automatic systems, thus they are expected to boost exports in Korea's automatic packaging industry in the future.
Packaging machine companies in Korea manufacture their equipment according to the diverse needs of consumers and are equipped with high production speed and fast processing ability. Plus, the machineries are provided with a quick warranty service unique to Korean companies. These merits have led to exports to 70 countries worldwide.
Since all industrial products go through a packaging stage before distribution, advanced automatic packaging technology can make a significant contribution to economic revitalization.
And sealing of products. We're continuously developing new technologies, and I think there are endless ways to provide convenience to people.
Now you can hear the machine is actually going off with the rice automatic packaging. Benefits of reducing material cost and streamlining distribution in the automatic packaging industry have helped encourage its growth. So therefore, Korea's automatic packaging machinery industry is forecast to grow into a 56 trillion won market in 2020, not to mention single-handedly create more than 150,000 jobs. The industry is maybe on track towards accounting for a major portion of the national economy in the near future. Over to you, Jinju.
Well, it definitely seems like a sector with great growth potential. Thank you, Jinju, for that report. That was our Kim Chen-ju reporting live on Korea's packaging machine industry.
We'll be right back. Good Monday morning. It's time to run through the front pages of your newspapers. And we'll go straight into 동아일보 to kick off in print this morning to have a look at this story here on the side. And this one is about the Samsung smartphone, the Galaxy S5. And the title says, copy to the bone. And as you can sense here in the title, this story is about the Galaxy S5 being copied completely from the exterior to the interior. And on the left is the original Galaxy S5 made by Samsung Electronics. On the right is the fake Galaxy S5 made over in China. Now, according to a local engineer that the paper interviewed, the Chinese Galaxy S5 is exactly the same as the original one, even the software of the gadget and, of course, the hardware. Now, what's more absurd is that these fake phones have the logo made in Korea on them, which the engineer stated just goes to show these makers do not have even the bare minimum of a conscience. Now, although the fake market is growing ever so large in China, global smartphone makers like Samsung and Apple are unable to act against the situation because of the Chinese government's high protection of domestic businesses. And next up is Gyeongyang Shinmun. We'll go ahead and look at this also on the side. And this one is about the Korea's top security advisor, what he is up to next. And it's called National Security Chief Kim Kwon-jin to visit the U.S. soon. Now, Kim is expected to visit Washington, D.C. sometime this month to discuss North Korea sanctions and other pending issues concerning the Korean Peninsula. He will be holding talks with his counterpart, National Security Advisor Susan Rice. And the two sides are still working out the details. And once the details are set, Kim's visit will become part of routine discussions held between the National Security Office and the White House National Security Council to reinforce cooperation between the two countries. And now going to our business dailies, let's first take a look at the Mail Business newspaper for the top story. And this article is called Low Interest Concerns Have Investors Going High Risk. Now, as fixed deposit rates have dropped to the 1% level, rich Koreans are turning their attention to more risky investments, including stock investment and relevant derivative products. Now, if you take a look at this graph, it shows that over 5 trillion won, or $5 billion, is flooding into equity-linked securities every month, while brokerage firms' special products offering relatively higher interest rates are selling like hotcakes as well. Now, more investors eyeing riskier investments largely comes as they cannot just sit and watch prolonged low interest rates, and expectations are turning bullish for the stock market. And finally, let's wrap with the Korea Economic Daily, and we'll take a look at this here towards the corner, close up. And this one's about the 2015 budget. And this is titled, Government to Hike Next Year's Budget by 5%. Now, the government, along with the ruling party, is considering raising the 2015 budget by about 5%, a move apparently aimed at boosting the economy while keeping the country's fiscal status still sound. The expansion is lower than the 6% increase requested by government ministries and agencies, and this lower-than-expected growth in the budget might be reflecting the concerns among lawmakers that fiscal health could be compromised due to increasing government spending amid a slowing economy and dwindling tax revenues. And that was a look at your newspaper headlines for this Monday, and now coming up are the stock numbers from Friday.
So over the weekend, we saw some big differences, temperature differences between day and night. Mm-hmm. So you need a jacket.
That's right. That's right. And that is signaling the entrance of autumn, where we set straight into fall. Mm-hmm. So keeping your windows open at night, that just might give you the common cold,
right,
or even the flu.
Mm-hmm. For a closer look at today's weather conditions, we'll go over to our Chun Sung-cho, who joins us from outdoors. Good morning to you, Sung-cho.
Good morning.
Good morning, guys. Today, we begin September with a rather cool morning, just like typical early autumn weather. Currently, the temperatures outside here in Seoul are just 20 degrees Celsius, and though some sporadic showers are in store for the central regions, midday highs will soar up to 30. Today, we have a high-pressure system over the northern part of the East Sea, giving out a bit of clouds all throughout the peninsula. And when it rains later in the afternoon, thunder and lightning may be on the way with strong winds. We have another round of nationwide rain in the forecast this week. It'll begin with Jeju and the southern regions tomorrow morning and spread all across the nation on Wednesday. Now, moving on to temperatures, like I said earlier, midday highs will rise up later on. With that, let's take a closer look at the temperature readings. Seoul and Gwangju will be the hottest at 30, while the rest of the nation hovers around the upper 20s. Gangneung is an exception, though, which will be the coolest at 24 degrees Celsius. Sunlight will be strong today, so protect your skin from UV rays by wearing sunscreen on your way out. This is all for me with the weather forecast. Back to you, Minjung.
Thank you, Song Cho. Let's get a check on the global headlines we're following on this first day of September. For that, we'll turn to our Eunice Kim, who joins us from the News Center. Good morning to you, Eunice.
Good morning, Minjung.
Now, Russian President Vladimir Putin has called for a statehood of eastern and southern Ukraine, but analysts are trying to decipher what exactly that means.
Right. Initially, when the interview of President Putin calling for that statehood ran on Sunday on Russian TV, some in the Western media questioned whether it meant Moscow was finally coming out to publicly support separatist demand for independence. Now, President Putin had also called on Kiev to launch immediate, substantive and meaningful talks toward that end, saying that statehood was necessary in order to protect the legitimate interests of people living there. His spokesman, though, later insisted that the comments did not amount to an endorsement of separatist rebels, adding that only Kiev can reach an agreement with New Russia, which is a term coined by the separatists for the territory they hold. President Putin, though, also said that Russia as a state cannot stand aside and do nothing while relatives and friends are being shot at by Ukrainian forces. He reminded the West that Russia is a strong nuclear power and that it's best not to mess with us, in his words. Kiev has said it is open for talks to give the territories more say in the way they are run, but refused to negotiate with the armed fighters they call international terrorists backed by Moscow. And political protests in Pakistan turned fatal Sunday as police clashed with opposition activists calling for the resignation of Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif. They allege Pakistan's leader was elected via corruption and election fraud, an allegation the 64-year-old has denied. The confrontation in Islamabad, the capital, was triggered late Saturday night, ending with three people killed and almost 400 others wounded. After the deadly clashes, Pakistan's army commanders expressed their concern but said they support democracy, as Prime Minister Sharif was elected in the country's first civilian transfer of power.
Meanwhile, on Sunday, an apartment collapsed in an eastern suburb of Paris, and I believe rescue operations are still ongoing.
Right. Residents of an apartment in Honi-sous-Bois were awakened by the sound of a blast around 8 a.m. local time on Sunday, and authorities believe it was most probably the result of a gas leak. A fire department spokesman reported that rescuers were still sorting through the rubble to search for 10 people missing. 12 people were pulled out of the debris alive. About four of them, though, were seriously hurt. And unfortunately, there are fatalities. A young child and an elderly woman have been reported killed in this partial building collapse. Residents of the remaining two-thirds of the building have been evacuated as the building was unsteady. France's Interior Ministry arrived at the, Interior Minister arrived at the disaster scene and pledged his support to the families and victims as an investigation has been launched. And with that, we'll wrap your look at the global headlines we are following this morning.
And still ahead, the trend of selfies takes on a sticky form, quite literally, and Korean college students making sure the world knows about hanbok or the Korean traditional dress. All of this and much more coming up on Viral Feed.
A legendary figure in the Korean classical music scene, Jung Myung-hoon, he has been the name for ages. And he started at a very young age. And even if you are not a fan of classical music here in Korea, they would know his name. And our Im Yoon-hee joins us on a special occasion that he's going to be holding. Good morning.
Right, good morning. So he's an award-winning musician as well as a conductor.
Yes.
He's had a prolific career both in Korea and abroad. And so he's been on the forefront of his field since the very early age of 7, and he's established himself both here and abroad as well. And so he's had a new plan coming up, and he has no signs of slowing down. Take a look.
Maestro Jung Myung-hoon is one of Korea's top conductors, and he's garnered world-class status over the years, performing with some of the top orchestras around the globe. He began playing instruments at the age of 5 and made his debut just 2 years later with the Seoul Philharmonic Orchestra. And over 50 years after that, in 2006, he made his way back to the Seoul Philharmonic as their artistic director and conductor. He and the Seoul Philharmonic Orchestra recently made their debut at the BBC Proms. And if he wasn't busy enough, Chung's decided to go back to the piano, the instrument that started it all. Last year, he released his first piano solo album, called Jung Myung-hoon Piano, which is a short compilation of well-known pieces, including Mozart's variation of Twinkle Twinkle Little Star and Beethoven's For Elise. He's called it a lighthearted project, and this year he's set to perform on his first ever solo piano tour. He'll travel around the country in October for a total of 5 performances that will consist of all 4 Chopin ballads, Brahms' 4 pieces for piano opus 119, along with some other classical masterpieces.
Now he's very well known as a member of the Chung Trio with his two siblings, right?
Can't forget them, right?
How, and tell us his process of getting into conducting.
Right, so he started conducting in 1979, and so since then he's led many internationally acclaimed opera houses and orchestras, such as the London Symphony, the Berlin Philharmonic, the Vienna Philharmonic, you know, Radio France. Like, the list goes on and on. Mm-hmm. So he really has accomplished quite the career. And so, you know, the Seoul Philharmonic is very fortunate to have him here because he has years of experience to offer, both from abroad and his experiences as a conductor and musician.
Mm-hmm. So we know of him as a conductor. That's how he's well known for. But he started out playing the piano. Now,
right,
what's the reason for going back to his roots?
So he said in an interview that he wanted to, at the age of 60, go back to his roots.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did start on the piano. That is where he did come from in terms of the musical career. And so he turned 60 last year and has decided to go back to the piano. And so last year he did release his piano album, and this year he's following suit with the concerts.
And as you mentioned, he's 60 years old, and he's showing no signs of slowing down.
Right.
It really looks like, you know, the older you get with classical music, the more it's more like aged wine, and it ages very well, right? So after his tour with the Seoul Philharmonic, he has a solo thing coming up?
He does have a solo thing. So he, like you said, is very busy not slowing down. He has another performance as well on September 10th, which is right around the corner. He will be performing with the Asia Philharmonic Orchestra, which he did establish in 1997 with some of Asia's top musicians. And so that's another thing to look forward to. So after that, he will be performing his solo concerts in October. So lots of things on the calendar for him and for the classical music field.
Exactly. A lot of treats for the classical music fans. Thank you very much, Yoon-hee.
That's a pleasure.
And stay with us on Korea Today, because coffee is where it's at. Whether it's Americano, iced, blended, or whatever you want, it seems that coffee is everywhere, and everyone has a cup of coffee and a conversation to go along with it. So we'll be looking at a bit of Korean coffee culture. Now, Siegfried Bauer has a few questions about Korea's coffee culture, so he visits coffee franchises that line the streets, learns about the popularity of instant coffee mix in the country, and teaches us a bit of coffee history on Ins and Outs.
Yeah. And time to check what's trending online. Over the weekend, an international pro wrestling competition was held in Pyongyang for the first time in 19 years.
That's right. A prominent Japanese wrestler turned politician was behind this event and what many are saying was part of sports diplomacy between Tokyo and Pyongyang. We'll turn to our Seo Mi-sorang for more on this. Good morning to you, Mi-sorang.
Good morning.
Good morning, but I guess they didn't want to mend ties with the South or the States because they opened the event with another verbal attack on both countries for their joint military drills. But once things got started, more than 13,000 people looked on as the 20 or so pro wrestlers put on a good stage show. Although it was a largely foreign sport to them, the crowd quickly got into the swing of things and excitedly cheered them on. Now, in North Korea, this is the first major sporting event with foreign star athletes since the basketball game for Kim Jong-un's birthday last January. But this time, the dictator did not attend the event. So that's what happened up north. Now, back home down south, the massive swarm of locusts down in Haenam-gun County has been brought under control. It all began about a week ago when billions and billions of locusts suddenly appeared in Haenam-gun County of Jeollanam-do Province and started eating at the precious crops of rice and millet there. The county quickly spread insecticide over all the affected regions, but not before the locusts damaged around 100,000 square meters of farmland. Meanwhile, starting today, those serving their compulsory military service will be able to have visitors during the weekdays as well, as opposed to just on weekends. And a lot of people are talking about the earlier than usual Chuseok this year. Now, like most other traditional holidays here in Korea, Chuseok is calculated on the lunar calendar and so falls on different days every year on the Gregorian calendar. Now, speaking of Chuseok, many are choosing produce from Jindo Island to give as Chuseok gifts. They're hoping this will boost the sluggish economy there, which has been doing not so well since the Sewol ferry disaster. And this includes the main rival parties as well. The ruling Saenuri Party gave Jindo abalone to its party members, while the main opposition party, the New Politics Alliance for Democracy, also chose local specialties from Jindo Island. Now, judging from the responses online, most people are in support of this goodwill gesture, with some even following suit. And with that, it's a wrap for today's edition of your Daily News Sum Up.
And a good Monday morning to you all as we kick things off with the 2014 World Badminton Championship, where the Korean men's double team were guaranteed a gold medal after the Lee Yong-dae, Yoo Yeon-sung and Shin Baek-cheol, Ko Sung-hyun pairs advanced to the finals. But quite a surprise during the final as the 10th-ranked duo of Shin Baek-cheol and Ko Sung-hyun beat out the top-ranked Lee Yong-dae and Yoo Yeon-sung duo 2-sets-1, winning the men's double gold. And with the gold medal finish, it's the first time in 11 years that Korea has claimed a gold medal. And now, speaking of first place finishes, 18-year-old Chung Hyun, playing at the Bangkok Open Challenger, became the youngest Korean to win a Challenger tournament. Facing off against Australia's Jordan Thompson in the men's final, Chung Hyun cruises through in straight sets 7-6, 6-4 after being down 2-5 in the first set. The first place finish makes him the youngest Korean to win at a Challenger event, giving him a nice $50,000 prize as well. And now shifting over to the 2014 FIBA World Cup currently taking place in Spain, the Korean national basketball team lost against Angola 80-69 in their first game and went up against Australia on Sunday. Now trying to bounce back from their first loss, the Korean national team tried their best to stop the Australian offense, but their size and power too much as the ninth-ranked Australia dominated the entire game, winning 89-55. And now moving over to Sunday night's K-League Classic action, FC Seoul and Jeju United drew 0-0 with Jeonnam defeating Chungbuk 2-1 in a close matchup. Meanwhile, let's take a look at another big matchup here. Ulsan Hyundai Tigers taking on the Pohang Steelers. And of course, going into the game here, both sides playing very aggressively from the start with several yellow cards in the first half. But it's big man Kim Shin-ook in the 26th minute of the match who heads one past the goalkeeper for a 1-0 Ulsan lead. But just 3 minutes later, it's Pwang's Kang Soo Il that's the equalizer here as the match goes into the second half tied 1-1. But just 3 minutes after the second half kicks off, it's Kim Jae-sung who gives Pwang the 2-1 lead. Now with a total of 8 cards being handed out, including a red, Pwang hangs on to win this match 2-1. And now finishing things off with some Sunday night KBO action, the Tucson Bears remain red hot with a 10-6 win over the NC Dinos, with the SK Wyverns beating the Kia Tigers 4-3 and the Nexon Heroes shut out the Samsung Lions 7-0. Meanwhile, let's take a look at the Lotte Giants take on the LG Twins. And of course, going into the game here, third inning of the game, Hwang Jae-kyun deep to left field, got a two-run shot, and the Lotte Giants have a 2-0 lead. Fourth inning, Park Jong-yoon, an RBI single to center field, gives the Lotte Giants the 3-0 lead. Bottom of the sixth inning with Lotte up 5-0, Lee Byung-gyu, two-run double to left center, cuts the deficit to 5-2, but in the ninth inning, Hwang Jae-kyun closes the curtains with his second home run of the night, a solo shot, as the Lotte Giants win this game 6-2. And that's going to wrap it up for me. This has been SJ. Have a great rest of the day and see you guys again for your sports needs.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Simon Oh. We have what the world is trending about throughout the internet. It's all at our fingertips. It's time for Viral Feed. We have a lot of interesting stories to get into today. As you can see, quite a lineup, so let's get right into it. Moving on to our first story. Eagle-eyed viewers are probably already asking, what is that thing Simon is holding in his hand?
It's a putter.
It's my new high-tech putter. I'm trying to get SJ to feature me on his sports news. Hasn't happened yet.
It looks like a putter.
It looks like a putter. What this is, and some of you may already know about this, it's called a selfie stick. And what this is basically a telescoping rod, and at the end I place my mobile phone. You can also use your camera. And basically you do this and take a photo of yourself.
So you can get a group shot.
Can take a picture for
this
us.
I need something like this when I need a photo of me because my arms are so short and my head is so big, it always looks like it's up close magnified.
Oh, come on.
So for me, this helps a lot. But it's not just for taking selfies, because a lot of people have been using them in some very creative ways, as we'll see right now. When is it that you get the most out of your selfie stick? Well, obviously, if you're taking a trip by yourself, it comes in very handy. For example, this young gentleman went on a trip around Turkey all by himself. Look at the pics he got of himself. Now, also keep in mind that these sticks are useful for taking group photos. Because sometimes when you try to get all your friends in there, it's just like the one person holding the camera who's in the middle of the photo, and then no one else is able to really get in on the action. This young woman set out on a photo-taking adventure through Seoul, and the selfie stick allowed her to take pictures with strangers that she met along the way. Great icebreaker, I think, yeah? But then you have to be careful not to push too hard, like this young gentleman here. He tried to use the selfie stick for a pool shot.
Oh, no.
And it ended in a bit of a failure.
Right. Goodbye, no warranty on that.
Dropping both of them. There's only so much you can do with a stick. Going underwater, not necessarily one of them. Now, one thing that I just found out this morning as I was trying out the selfie stick for the first time, you might want to invest in a remote control, which is an accessory that's available. On the other hand, if you just want to use the stick itself, you need to use the timer on your phone. Otherwise, you end up looking stupid, like I did when I did this with the stick, and that sort of defeated the purpose. It didn't work very well. All right, now, moving on to our second story. Chuseok is just around the corner. It is a very major holiday here in Korea. And around this time of year, you may spot many people wearing hanbok, Korea's traditional attire. It's a trend we can see online these days and all across the globe. Let's have a look. Over in Japan, instead of trying on the Japanese traditional kimonos, these two young Korean college students decided to traverse through Kyoto wearing Korea's traditional hanbok. Now, the exact reasons for their outing in this attire were not completely clear. You can tell that they did draw some attention. A lot of people stopping to take photos. It was a sort of impromptu PR session for the traditional attire. Now, meanwhile, there are people who set off with the express purpose of sharing this part of Korean culture with the rest of the world. These college students we're seeing now traveled to Germany, Austria, Italy, the Czech Republic, and Switzerland. 5 different European countries while wearing hanbok, and they even held little events for people, such as writing their names in Korean on a Korean fan. It seemed to be quite a success among all the different Korean people that they met. Now, on top of all these efforts made by the young Korean generation, one of the top tourist attractions here in Korea has taken on a promotion for Hanbok. In October, the Jeonju Hanok Village will be hosting Hanbok Day, a day when everyone dons their traditional attire. And if you're interested, it's very easy to participate. Just look up this information, as you can see on your screen. It's Hanbok Day, held on October in the Jeonju Hanok Village. It sounds like fun.
Us here on Korea Today will be wearing hanbok, I believe, on the Chuseok Day this time around.
I'm going to warn you in advance, I can rock the hanbok. I definitely.
Okay.
I look better at a hanbok.
Is that a challenge? Because Young can rock the hanbok look.
Young, let's see. Are we going to do a little bit of
it? You know, it kind of helps cover all the fat. That's why you can rock it better than me.
Same for women as well.
That was my secret. We'll take a selfie of it together. Alrighty, moving on to our third story. This is super, super exciting. If I were to travel throughout the world, this is a theme that, despite my complete lack of dancing talent, I might like to try. This is about a guy who decided to go all across the world and have the time of his life in a very special way. Let's check it out. Now, this young man is known online as the Dancing Traveler. And as you can see from the videos, it's very fitting. 38-year-old Matthew Harding from the U.S. Now, he traveled throughout the world dancing and uploaded his visits online.
Wow.
Basically, what he did was, wherever he visited, he learned moves that were native to the country, so traditional dances, and he filmed himself dancing them. It didn't matter where he was. He even went to, as you can see here, Pyongyang, a country that's not known for being super open. He did get some tips. It looks interesting, doesn't it?
Trending dance.
That's my question. Yeah, I think so. And as you can see, it wasn't just himself dancing on his own. He had a lot of company. It seemed wherever he went, he was drawing crowds, and people were really interested to see how they could join in. We see Rome, Italy, and Prague, and the Czech Republic.
And whoever said that white man can't dance, right?
Actually, that's what I love about this video is that, and this talk about calling the kettle black, but this he's not the best dancer in the world, but it doesn't matter because he's so enthusiastic about it. And there's that old cliched nugget about dancing like no one's looking. This guy goes one better. He dances like he doesn't care that people are looking, and I think that's amazing. So far from the stores I've seen, what I would like to do is to take selfies of myself in a hanbok as I dance throughout the world.
Wow, are you combining all your stories now and putting it into everyone?
That said though, with our fourth and final story, it sounds like this is something that I would not go anywhere near unless I had, as I've said before with bungee jumping, a supply of diapers. It's terrifying. It's a series of acrobatics performed in the air. Let's have a look. These are the Blue Angels, the flight demonstration squadron of the U.S. Navy, known for their intense skills in the air. And every year, they hold air shows throughout the U.S. And here's the amazing part. Sometimes, a lucky few even get to experience the ride firsthand.
That has to be awesome.
You can see here. They get a ride along with the Blue Angels. This is just a vertical climb, but look how horrible that could be.
Are you serious?
Can you imagine the G's? It's just a complete vertical climb.
Wow.
Now look at this. This is a pilot who's used to this, and you can tell from his all his training, he's a bit more nonchalant. He's chewing gum, he does a barrel roll, no biggie. Just think of all the vertical and lateral G's. It's just unbelievable. They practice long and hard, and it must be, you know, definitely something difficult to get to that sort of level in the air. I couldn't imagine. Because I do have a little bit of a fear of flying, so sometimes even if I'm on just like a, you know, transcontinental flight in my comfortable seat, sipping on my soda, I still get kind of nervous.
Uh-huh.
So to imagine something like this, it's...
Yeah, you can cross that out off your list of things
three
to
for
do.
4 is not bad, right? The hanbok, the selfies, and dancing throughout the world.
Yeah, just right there.
I think you can just do it in there with all those, all of the above.
Ooh.
But are those people really passing out?
That's just a few seconds
now,
the photos, of course, that we saw today and the video, that's a bit more tame, but I'm told that some of the lateral Gs that you get on some of these rides, they're so intense that people do actually, literally, pass out. So that's, again, if you're into that sort of adrenaline rush, then, you know, look into that. For me, I think just watching the video is enough. Anyway, that's all we have for Viral Feed today. I had a lot of fun. I hope you did too. And I'll see you back next week with more. Ciao for now.
We always have coffee together and have a conversation over a nice warmer cold cup of coffee, right?
That's right.
And it's become a big thing these days.
Mm-hmm. It smells so nice in the studio right now because our guest for Ins and Outs for today has brought some coffee with him. Good morning. He's a doctor from Austria. Good morning to you. Could you please tell us about yourself a little bit?
Sure. Hi, good morning. My name is Siegfried Bauer. I'm from Austria, the Alps country. Mm-hmm. And we love coffee too. I came to Korea 11 years ago with my wife and one daughter, and I work as a pediatrician now in Korea.
Okay, so you've seen the coffee experience go during its boom, basically. You know, 10 years ago is when it basically started coming in, and then it really, really multiplied exponentially. So tell us a little bit about your experience watching the coffee grow.
Well, I can see there's a big variety of coffee culture, and as Austrians, we love coffee. You know, we have like deep espressos with milk and cream normally, but I saw that the Korean coffee culture is really different. So, and I wanted to find out more about it. What do Koreans like about the coffee?
So you went out to the streets and to all these coffee shops to experience the coffee culture yourself. So why don't we take a look at it?
Yes, sure.
Okay.
The first place I went for Korea's coffee culture, Myeongdong in downtown Seoul. Do you see all these coffee store franchises along the street? There are many cafes, but there are also many people walking around with coffee. Now, just in Myeongdong area, there are over 1,000 coffees.
I tell you, there are coffee shops all over here. But actually, it looks great because you can have a joyful time. In Austria, we don't have so many coffee shops, you know, just a few little. Of course, it's quiet. But if you want to have a joyful, fun time, I think it's great here, right? Enjoy!
The coffee franchises started flocking to Korea in great amounts around the year 2000. That changed the coffee culture here from instant coffee to brewed coffee, and people started showing more interest in varying depths of taste. Coffee imports continued to rise as well, with surveys showing one Korean adult aged 20 or over drinks about 298 cups of coffee per year.
Wow. It's almost every day, every weekday at least.
Yeah.
I think I drink more than that, actually.
We took a mini survey of our own and what the secret charm of franchise coffee was.
American cappuccino, latte, macchiato, latte, mocha latte, maple, hazelnut.
So many different types.
그냥 제일 많이 나가는
So the biggest sell at the franchise was actually Americano, coffee made from adding water to espresso.
Ooh, that's good.
In other words, I guess that the favorite coffee for Korean customers here was this drink, so let's try it.
So-called Americano.
You're using that stick.
It was my first time. And actually, I don't drink coffee at these franchises normally, so I was very curious about the taste.
Tastes like water with a little coffee taste. I don't really like coffee. So if that's really the most popular drink for the Koreans, I'm surprised.
Not so impressed.
It's not mine.
Yeah, actually, I was thinking about the coffee houses in Austria. Because the coffee is just very different from this franchise taste. We have thick espresso with whipped cream and milk. But here in Korea, I wonder why they like the taste of this Americano. It was the time for me to try out in interviews.
Oh.
혹시 어떤 커피 좋아하세요?
아메리카노 좋아해요.
아메리카노요? 그 혹시 이유 있어요? 왜 아메리카노 좋아하시는지요?
그냥 깔끔해서
식사하고 나서 깔끔하게 아, 주로, 마무리할 수 있어요.
에스프레소는 너무 써서 못 마시고 그래서 아메리카노를 좋아해요.
It was really interesting to hear all the different reasons. So now let's find out why people like the franchise cafes.
여러 명 만날 때는 이제 좀 만나기 쉬운 장소에 있는 카페이다 보니까 보게 되는 것 같아요. 그럴 때.
아무래도 프랜차이즈 커피집은 맛이 다 똑같잖아요. 그래서 어디를 가도 제가 모르는 장소를 가도
와이파이도 되고 주변에 많이 있으니까 직원도 친절하고
The fringe benefits, right?
Yeah. Did you notice that the customers at Myeongdong are all quite young people?
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So I wondered where the old generation was, and I met some of them at the Tapgol Park.
That's right, Tapgol공원.
안녕하세요.
Vending machine.
안녕하세요. 여기서 뭐 하세요?
커피 마시고 있습니다.
아, 커피요? 이거 어디서 나온 커피야?
자판기 커피라고.
싸고
맛있고.
이런 맛은
Yeah, I offered them a little bit of what the younger generation liked, the Americano.
흘려가지고.
What is this, they're saying?
맛이 없어요. 젊은 사람들만 좋아.
Doesn't have sweet at all.
그러니까 이제 커피가 그런 프림이 아니라 싱거워.
아,
근데 이제 이건.
Oh, that's so endearing.
Cream. Cream, yeah, it's a coffee creamer that was made in Korea back in the year 1974. That was during a time when instant coffee was a trend in Korea. And instead of using milk, it was quite expensive at that time. They added cream, which countered the bitter taste of the coffee beans and really helped push the coffee culture along, actually.
And it tastes so good on it its does. Own, too.
Right. I remember taking spoonfuls.
Right,
so even now,
right?
it plays a big role because coffee mixes with sugar, coffee, and powder cream are very popular these days. Let me show also something interesting about, found out about the coffee mixes. This is a stationery and supply store, but what I could find, they have also coffee mixes there.
Ah. Coffee, even in the stationery. Instant coffee in all kind of brands and forms. I'm very surprised. And I think you didn't expect it either, right?
궁금한 거 있는데요.
예.
여기 왜 커피 파는지 저 이해 잘 모르겠는데.
저희 주변 상권에도 사무실 고객이 굉장히 많고 사무실에서 커피를 굉장히 많이 사용하기 때문에 저희가 판매를 하고 있습니다.
오, 몰랐어요.
It's a stationary product now.
Yeah, most of the coffee the Koreans consume in their office building actually. And if you visit any office, you'll notice they always have these coffee mixes like this. Actually, because it's very simple to make, just add hot water, right? Mm-hmm.
And you have to use the packaging to stir.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You cannot use a regular spoon. You have to have the packaging.
And the mix is actually also very popular these days in overseas too. Aren't you curious about where this instant coffee mix is originated? Actually, it started with Korean's tabang coffee.
Tabang coffee?
Yeah, tabang actually can be literally translated into a place that sells teas. But what was the connection? So I got part of my answers at the Tabang, the place where you can get coffee already for 30 years before there were all these franchises.
Huh.
So let's try some Tabang coffee.
Ah, there is Tabang coffee.
And of course, I could find it on the menu.
Can I have Tabang coffee?
Yes.
Yes.
So I couldn't wait to try this Tabang coffee with a 30-year-old history. But actually in the kitchen I learned that the owner, all she did was just pour 2 spoons of instant coffee in a boiling cup of water.
This is Tabang coffee?
Yeah, this is Tabang coffee. Oh, she speaks good English.
It carries the biggest profit margin.
How
to drink? Two and two.
So I decided to learn about the Tabang coffee by myself, directly from the owner.
I usually go by two spoons of sugar.
Yeah, basically it's 2 spoons of instant coffee in hot water, then plus 2 spoons of sugar and 2 spoons of powdered creamer. Of course, you can add more sugar or creamer if you want.
Well, our parents probably fell in love with that cup of coffee over that cup of coffee, right?
It's a little bit creamier than the instant coffee, and the coffee tastes a little bit smoother. It tastes nice, I think, for the cloudy weather and if it's rainy.
So that is how I ended my day of the coffee culture research with a smooth, sweet cup of coffee.
Wow, you're like a reporter set out to uncover the truth about the coffee culture, going to places, interviewing people.
It was very interesting.
Yeah?
You know, did you really like the Tabang coffee? What did you think about it?
Yeah, kind of. Actually, in Austria, like, espresso with whipped cream and milk, and it has this smooth, creamy taste.
We call it the Vienna coffee, right?
Right. Mm. And I felt the Tabang coffee has similar taste, maybe because of the primer.
Mm. Ah. It's a lot sweeter, Tabang coffee,
it's
right?
It's sweeter, that's right.
It's more intense.
That's maybe half sugar, maybe.
At the end of the day, which was your favorite type?
Basically, personally, I like the freshly roasted coffee. Uh-huh. So brewing at home, or nowadays they have a lot of roaster coffees in Korea, I found.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Where you can get the beans right, and they right. do it for you right on the spot.
So they have really big variety of coffee offering in Korea mm-hmm. like these days.
And after your journey through all these different coffee shops, what do you think stands out the most in Korea's coffee culture?
I feel it's really the big variety. Mm-hmm. And so like anyone, according to his taste, they can choose. They have like the roastery coffees, they have the franchise coffees, mm-hmm. and you can have also the vending machine coffee.
Exactly, and they also have those hand-drip coffees that are right. coming out these days. Mm-hmm. And there's such a variety. I think many people get they're surprised or taken aback by the number of coffee shops that there
true.
Are in Korea.
It's true. It's really overwhelming. Mm-hmm.
But for those who like to enjoy coffee from home, you go with those the blends, right? But we also have like these other exotic types of blends, and these are some examples of it, right?
Right. You can see here they have nowadays also popular very much. The capsule coffee.
Right, mm-hmm. it's one of the
so
most popular ones.
It's easy to make and the price is a little bit.
Oh, it smells so good.
Oh, it smells so good. Oh, I can
we have one of these machines in the office.
And then you have the mocha pot, so you can brew coffee with mocha pot. Or also, you want to try a cup of coffee, I can make you maybe a fresh
please,
brewed coffee.
Yes, please. Yes.
So this is freshly ground Oops. Coffee. Uh-huh. And you basically, is, you go
smell?
With hot water.
Oh, God.
So this is the hand drip. I always wanted to know, is there a reason that you're swirling it around, or is there a certain way to do it?
Sure. I do it actually now in a fast way, just short of time. But actually, it's to go in circular motion, so it's evenly. Uh-huh. The coffee will be in touch with the water, mm-hmm. and then you extract it evenly. Uh-huh. Otherwise, you just get out of the middle, and okay. then it can be bland.
There's something very professional about the way you're doing it. Something.
Making a swirl.
It's just homework. Every day. Daily life.
Cameras can't catch it, but when I do it, what happens is all the coffee kind of moves up to the sides of the
right. Yeah, because you're pouring it into that little hole. You're not supposed to. You're supposed to swirl.
Because if you go just in the middle, then it will push the coffee to the corners. Mm-hmm. So and also, you shouldn't go to the sides, so otherwise you have just a filter taste.
Okay.
Uh-huh. So does this have a milder taste than what we have from the machine, or
sure,
how different does it taste?
But it also depends on the grinding. So uh-huh. if you have like a cross grinding, then it's more mild. If you have a very smooth, fine grinding, it will be stronger. Mm.
You know, coffee is quite a difficult subject. It's got a lot of different ways of enjoying.
So maybe I can give you a little sip of trying the fresh
our morning coffee.
It's a lot of labor.
All right. Okay. But so you do this every morning for your wife and yourself?
Yes.
Huh?
Wow. At home.
Really?
With devotion.
Every morning for your wife?
Devotion. See, underlying actually, devotion.
I use also actually the capsule I have at home.
I think I'll go with
because
the capsule.
It has a good taste. And I mean, it's a price difference, of course, because I think one capsule is by 900 to 1,000 won,
right.
I think. But
I'll just take a little.
Nice, I'm excited. Yay.
Thank you, here you go.
Oh, this will wake us up towards the end of the show.
Thank you. But,
thank you.
But you know, if you want to share with the family and if it's a little cheaper or you like uh-huh. the taste of fresh ground coffee,
oh,
I think it's
it.
A good way.
Mm, it's good.
And it brings out
so
the flavor.
Much.
Right, it's definitely not like water in espresso.
This is the real
most popular
stuff.
Right, well, thank you very much for the coffee, Mr. Bauer.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. I had a good time. I learned a lot about Korean culture.
Yeah, I learned a lot from you too.
We learned a lot about coffee too, and the motion that you did with the coffee pot. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Well, this is where we say goodbye with a cup of coffee.
I think it's the first time that we've actually had a cup of coffee to close the show with.
Nice.
I know. A good way to close the show.
Perfect. We should do this a little more often. That's a word to our producers. We'll see you back here tomorrow morning at 7 a.m.
Bye-bye.